Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm going to start. I have a brief introduction, and I know some students might be coming in as I speak. But thank you for being here. It's a great honor to have Matias Spektor here with us today. I'm Denisse Yanovich. I'm the managing director of the Georgetown Americas Institute. And just briefly, I'll let you know about the institute. Many of you might not have heard of it. It's a new, relatively new institute at the university. We've been around for like 2 years now, more or less. And basically, we are a platform to bring Latin America to Georgetown and Georgetown to Latin America. I'll a brief summary of what we do. We do that through events, through research, and in this case, through visiting fellows, resident fellows, sorry. Matias is our first resident fellow at the Georgetown Americas Institute. And then as part of our work in 2022, we launched the Spotlight on the Americas series. It's throughout the semester, we have between 8 and 10 events under this series, where we bring experts on different topics to talk about climate change, the economy, truth and reconciliation. We've had all types of speakers, and today we have the pleasure to have Matias. Matias is a professor of politics and international relations at the Fundación Getúlio Vargas in Brazil. He specializes in international security, climate politics, and transnational political violence with a focus on Latin America and the Global South. He has been a visiting scholar at, hold your horses, this is a long list, Princeton University, the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, the Council on Foreign Relations, the London School of Economics, King's College London, and he can now add Georgetown University to that impressive list. He holds a PhD from Oxford University. Our event will start with a presentation by Matias, who will talk about his recent research on climate change politics and policies in the region, followed up with some questions from me, actually one or two, not many, and then we'll open up for questions from all of you. Matias is a professor. He's really used to having back and forths with students, so we welcome really your participation in this event. Some of his current research on the topic include, these are the titles, Climate Change Beliefs and Their Correlates in Latin America. Another one is called National Backlash Against Foreign Climate Shaming, Triggers of Defiance, why mass publics double down on anti-climate behavior and costless defection, and then when leader criticism of the Paris Agreement pays off. We are very, very lucky to have him with us, and as we were speaking earlier, this is Latin America is so important for the conversation around climate change and how to effectively formulate public policy around this issue is so important. So Matias's research is incredibly timely and important. So thank you.
Thank you so much for coming. So what I thought I'd do today is, rather than give you just one paper, is summarize three papers that I've done in recent months with co-authors and give you a summary by way of making an argument about the role of public opinion in climate politics in Latin America. And the reason why this matters, I think, is that the story that comes out of Latin America is so unusual when we compare it to the story of domestic public opinion and climate policy in other parts of the world. We don't know an awful lot about how public opinion intersects with climate politics beyond the West. There are many studies in the United States, there are several studies in Western Europe, and there is study in India. But beyond that, we know very little. And what my co-authors and I have been trying to do is change the trend by producing the first set of systematic studies on how publics react and respond to climate policy and climate change in particular. So let's get started. When we ask why public sentiment matters for the conduct of climate policy, the answer has three parts to it. It matters, first of all, because depending on how publics develop their beliefs about climate change, that determines how far skeptics can go. Climate skeptics in the United States can go a long way because there's very large numbers of Americans who don't believe in the existence of climate change or in the anthropogenic causes of climate change or don't believe that the effects of climate change are going to be severe. Hence, the field is open, wide open, for skeptics to push their arguments. But there's another side to the story, and this is to do with how far pro-climate actors can go in promoting climate action. To what extent will the people actually react to messages coming from pro-climate action, pro-climate actors, and, you know, go out and vote in pro-climate candidates, for example, or go out and protest against decisions by governments to implement anti-climate policy. And then finally, beliefs among the mass public help us understand to what extent the international community can shape climate policy. So take, for instance, the Paris Agreement. The Paris Agreement is an agreement based on voluntary commitments by countries. Countries voluntarily commit to reducing carbon emissions. When countries don't honor that pledge, the enforcement mechanism in the Paris Agreement is this. There will be naming and shaming. An independent group of scientists will tell the country, you're out of compliance, you need to get your act together. That only works if domestic public opinion, if voters understand that message and act on that message in ways that threaten politicians with a vote of no confidence if they don't act in ways that are consistent with the commitments they've made under the Paris Agreement. So understanding where public opinion is rather crucial in making sense of how far countries can go in actually responding to the climate crisis in a way that is effective. So, as I said, lots of knowledge about how this thing works in the United States, some work coming from Europe, virtually nothing coming from the non-Western world, with the single exception of India. So my colleagues and I decided to run the first comprehensive regional survey. We picked seven countries from Latin America, which put together account for 80% of carbon emissions in the region. We interviewed over 5,000 people in these seven countries, and our samples are representative of the nations, right? So the same proportion of male and female and wealthier people and poorer people, urban people and countryside people, so on and so forth. And we began by asking questions about beliefs. We wanted to map out what Latin Americans believe. And the literature on climate change beliefs tells us that there are three different types of belief. And these not necessarily go together, and that's why we need to study them separately. There's the belief in the existence of climate change, that climate change occurs. That's one thing. Different thing is the belief that the causes of climate change are human rather than natural cycles in the Earth climate. And then there's the belief in the severity of the consequences of climate change. As I said, these three things don't necessarily go together, and we need to understand to what extent Latin Americans believe in these things. So, for example, in the United States, public opinion is very severely divided and polarized over the reality of climate change. A lot of people don't believe climate change actually exists, and it's deeply divided over the causes, and is deeply divided over the consequences. In Europe, there's less division about the reality, but a lot of division over causes, and lots of division over consequences. So we wanted to know what the story was in Latin America, but not just that. On top of mapping beliefs, we wanted to understand risk assessment. What's the risk perception Latin Americans have of climate change? Do they think it's dangerous? Do they see it as an imminent threat, or do they not? And drawing on political psychology, we know that the best way to measure risk perception is to look at it from two different dimensions. One is a spatial dimension. So how much you think climate change will affect not only your life and the life of your family, but also your neighbors, the people who live in your city, the people who live in your state, the people who live in your country, the people who live in your region. Space. The other one is temporal. When do you think this thing is going to affect you? Is it an imminent threat? Is it present? Are you already suffering the effects of climate change? Or is this something for future generations, maybe 10, 20, 30 years down the line? We wanted to understand risk perception in Latin America over climate change. So let me show you what we found. And I'm going to start with very basic descriptive statistics. And the findings are amazing. First of all, there's overwhelming belief in the existence of climate change. Very different from the United States, okay? There's virtually no space in Latin America for skeptics to question the existence of climate change. And this is really interesting because now you begin to understand why politicians who don't believe or who run for office on an anti-climate platform never question the existence of climate change. They question other things. Very different message than the message you get from politicians in the United States. So virtual consensus that it exists. Of course, one already thinks, okay, if there is consensus around the existence, why is there so little climate action? Most Latin Americans don't vote around issues of climate change at all. And there's very, very little social pressure for action. So there's a disconnect there that one needs to explore. So that's the results around belief in the existence of climate change. Then how about the origins, the causes of climate change? Again, big social consensus, enormous consensus that the causes are human, that this is not a natural cycle in the planet's trajectory. Here's where the division comes. It's around the severity of its consequences. So climate skeptics in Latin America will naturally focus on the severity of consequences, because it's here that we see a lot of division. In Colombia, which ranks super high in the other two beliefs, here there's a very significant minority of people who don't believe that the consequences of climate change are severe. And in Brazil, it polarizes society. About half the people of Brazil don't think the consequences will be severe. And this is crucial for informing policy, because the messages politicians and activists need to advance, need to attend to this reality, because there's no point in trying to convince Latin Americans that climate change exists. They already believe it, or that it's caused by humans. They already believe it. It's a matter of drilling the issue of consequences. That is...
One quick question, Matias. When were the surveys done? What year?
So this is December 2021. Okay, so I gave you descriptive statistics. Now I want to give you a bit more. I want to understand what the correlates of these beliefs are. In other words, I want to understand what is causing these beliefs. What are the triggers that lead to these beliefs? And in the political psychology literature, there's a long list of factors that could potentially account for these beliefs. And we tested each one of them. So I'm going to give you an ugly graph, but don't worry, I'm going to explain what we're doing. So we're looking at beliefs in the existence of climate change, the causes of climate change, and the impacts of climate change. And I want to identify what predicts these beliefs in Latin America. And we tested things like knowledge. Does knowledge matter? Do Latin Americans who have more knowledge, either subjective or objective, you know, more years in college, does that make a difference? If you educate people, does that make a dent in whether they believe in the existence, the human causes, and the severe consequences? And the answer is no. In Latin America, it has no effect at all. Very strange. Different from the United States, different from Europe. Level of education makes no dent. The one thing that makes a hell of a difference when it comes to the existence of climate change, this means the farther away this line is from the dotted vertical line, the bigger the statistical effect of this factor. It's the belief in scientific consensus. Latin Americans are convinced that climate change exists when they believe there's scientific consensus around the existence of climate change. It's not trust in scientists, which we find to be relatively low. It's trust in consensus. And this helps us explain why so many climate skeptics in Latin America push the button of the absence of scientific consensus. They will invite bogey scientists to TV shows and radio shows to say, well, actually, there is no consensus, because it breeds the notion that maybe climate change doesn't really exist. But belief in scientific consensus is the driving force there. Not trusting scientists. When the blue line touches the vertical dotted line, there's no statistical effect whatsoever. Let me say something about psychology. We looked at education. We looked at levels of trust. We are looking as well at a psychological factor, which is a level, your level of individualism, on a scale of individualism, where you fit. And what we find is that Latin Americans who rank high on a scale of individualism, this is where we find negative belief. So highly individualistic Latin Americans don't believe that the causes are human and don't believe that the impact is severe. And this is the strongest predictor of not believing in the causes and the impact of climate change. So there's something about individualism that is driving the story here in ways that it simply doesn't in other parts of the world. And this is really worrying, and I'm going to talk about it more in a minute, but it's really worrying in Latin America, because Latin America is a region of the world that has seen levels of social trust go down dramatically over the years. There's been a rise in individualism in the region. And we know that individualism correlates with disbelief in the causes and impact of climate change. And then finally, really interesting story. How about experience of extreme weather events? Many Latin Americans are now subject to experiences of extreme weather, oftentimes very dramatic, because a lot of the places that suffer these events are not prepared, are not resilient enough to cope with the impacts. And here's what we find. Personal experience with extreme weather events affects belief in the existence of climate change, but it doesn't make a dent in belief in the human causes and the severe consequences. It's almost as if the experience of extreme weather events doesn't translate. It's almost as if people have a hard time connecting extreme weather events with climate change. They may think extreme weather events are disconnected from climate change, are to do with something else. something else, like, for example, poor governance in the design of sewage systems, or, for example, with endemic corruption in the construction of housing projects. And when it rains and it pours, these places collapse. And rather than turn to climate change as the immediate cause of these problems, people turn to something else. Really worrying. So these are the drivers of belief. The single most powerful driver here is scientific consensus in the belief in the existence of climate change. And then the other driver is levels of individualism. Then we wanted to check and wanted to see whether we could come up with a profile of a Latin American skeptic. In the United States and in Western Europe, your average skeptic, climate skeptic, tends to be on the political right, tends to be more conservative, and tends to be older. It also tends to be less educated. So if you wanted to design a profile, an ideal profile, that would be it. By the same token, if you wanted to find who in the United States is more committed to climate action, you would invert this. It's younger, blue state, highly educated people that tend to be the most staunch believers in the existence, the human causes, and the severe consequences of climate change. In Latin America, we couldn't come up with that profile. And this is really fascinating to me. Whether you're on the left or on the right makes no difference whatsoever in your belief in the existence or the human causes of climate change. It has a small statistical effect on whether you believe the impacts of climate change are going to be severe. But belief in climate change in Latin America is not something of the left. It has no partisan ideology attached to it. Your gender has no effect at all. Your level of education has no effect at all. Your income has no effect at all. Your age doesn't matter. Your race doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is your religion. If you're Pentecostal, if you come from a Pentecostal denomination, you are less likely to believe that the consequences of climate change are going to be severe. But there is no socio-demographic profile. Huge social consensus around these things in Latin America. Okay, so these were the questions about beliefs. How about risk perception? So we asked questions about the spatial extent and the temporal immediacy of risk perception, and we came up with an index, and we joined these two factors in one index, and this is what we found. By and large, most Latin Americans believe climate change to be a very serious and immediate threat. What are the drivers of risk perception in the region? And here we did the same, and I'm going to summarize the argument, what we found. Your level of knowledge has very little impact, if you're Latin American, on whether your sense of risk is heightened or not. There are many other things that have no effect. For example, personal experience with extreme weather events, no effect. Your perception of vulnerability in the future to extreme weather event has some effect, but personal experience has no effect. So the notion that Latin Americans who suffer the consequences of climate change are going to become pro-climate actors, players, there's no reason to believe that that will be the case. So there's no political market, really, for candidates for office who will go to regions that have been deeply affected by climate change, of which there are many in Latin America and in growing numbers, offering these people a pro-climate platform. This is really serious. None of the other things has any effect, with one exception, which is levels of worry. There's a scale of worry in political psychology. We humans can rank high on that scale or rank low, whether you're a person who worries a lot or whether you're a person who worries little. And your level of worry is the single largest predictor of climate change risk perception in Latin America. It's not cognitive, it's psychological. It's not to do with education. It's not to do with experience with extreme weather events. It's not something that you learn. It's something that you feel. It's instinctive. Your political ideology makes no dent in this story. Or your, as I said, level of education. Religion here doesn't matter. Income doesn't matter. Age or race doesn't matter. The one thing that matters is your gender. So who are the Latin Americans who believe risk perception to be climate risk, to be high? It's women who worry. And the reason why these two things go together, I think, is the fact that in Latin America, some of the biggest effects of climate change are on public health. So things like diseases like Zika, chikungunya, and dengue are deeply related with climate change. And the people in Latin America who care most for the health of others, of their family, their elders, so on and so forth, are women. So if you want to find who in Latin America is worried about this, is women with high levels of worry. We've never tested these, but I would say that young women would rank higher, in particular because they worry about the kinds of diseases that affect the life of pregnant women and the life of babies, I think. No one's done that study yet, but I reckon that's what one would find if one were to explore these things in greater detail. So this was the first attempt, to my knowledge, to map out beliefs in climate change in Latin America and risk perception in Latin America. And from these, we learn an awful lot. Latin America is very different from wealthier societies like the United States and Europe. Some of the news are really positive. There is no partisan divide. This is good news in the sense that it means that one could plausibly imagine a social consensus around the need for climate action, which is not going to be questioned and polarized each step of the way, as it is the case in the United States and in Europe, and that's good. But on the other hand, there's something really difficult here, which is to do with the fact that knowledge, cognition, doesn't seem to cut the mustard. There's something at the level of psychology, your level of individualism, your level of worry. These are the main determinants. So this tells us something about the strategies that climate skeptics adopt in Latin America. And this is really important for politicians and pro-climate actors and NGOs to come up with intelligent strategies to counter the argument of climate skeptics. So, what are the strategies of skeptics? Skeptics in Latin America, intuitively knowing the results of these surveys, here's what they normally do. They will question the severity of climate change, not its existence and not its human origins. They will also question the scientific consensus around climate change. They, intuitively knowing that levels of individualism determine how much you believe that climate change is a problem, they will frame climate policy as a threat to individual freedoms. And having these three, knowing these three things, one can imagine what the counter-narrative should be what pro-climate actors should try to say in order to fight back against climate skepticism in this region. The message, the pro-climate message, needs to be climate action as choice and empowerment. It cannot be about, for example, increasing the outreach of the state and having the state control more areas of economic activity, for example, or having the state dictate whether you can use a car or you cannot use a car. Unless pro-climate actors in Latin America adopt a language that reinforces individual choice and freedom as part of the package, it's going to be very tricky to get that, in the case of Brazil, 44% of the population who don't believe the impacts of climate change are severe, or the 24% of the population in Colombia who don't think the consequences are going to be severe. So what I've just presented you is two different papers. The first one has been accepted for publication, and it's coming out in the next few weeks in Nature Communications. And the second one is now under review at a different journal, but hopefully it will come out in the next few months. So these were the two studies I wanted to mention to you on the issue of beliefs and risk perception. Now I want to introduce a third study. And the third study looks at the role of foreign climate criticism. Latin America is one of the regions of the world that has been subject to most intensive foreign criticism over the protection of critical biomes. The case of the Amazon is, many people know it, there's been an awful lot of foreign criticism around the issue of the Amazon, but not just the Amazon, many other biomes in many other parts of Latin America beyond the Amazon river basin and the 7-8 countries that are part of that basin have been the subject of foreign climate criticism. So we need to understand how public opinion in these countries reacts to foreign criticism around climate change, okay? Let me try first convince you that foreign climate criticism is a big deal and is becoming a bigger deal and is bound to become a super, super big deal moving forward, even bigger moving forward. So President Biden's climate plan from the last election calls for naming and shaming climate outlaws. This means whenever there's a country that doesn't comply with the letter and the spirit of the Paris Agreement or any other legal commitment, Biden's climate plan calls for denouncing this country publicly as an instrument of foreign policy. Naming and shaming is a recurrent instrument when it comes to human rights, for example. And it's now becoming common currency in the climate sphere as well. The Pentagon in 2021 declared climate change a risk to national security, which has a lot of legal consequences. Not the least, it allows the UN Security Council to begin to treat climate change as a threat to international peace and stability, which is the code word for enacting Security Council resolutions. The Inflation Reduction Act in the United States and EU new regulations allow for the formal naming and shaming of countries that don't comply with certain regulations, and it allows the United States and Europe to impose what in practice is a carbon tax on the border. It's a new form of protectionism, critics would say, way outside the WTO framework, so a real threat to countries that depend on the US and European markets for their exports. The IMF and the World Bank now demand that borrowers, and Latin Americans are big borrowers of both the World Bank and the IMF, to produce inventories of their climate assets, opening the door for potential criticism from abroad. And then there's a recent development, which is the idea pushed by several NGOs that rather than produce governance around climate politics centered on sovereign jurisdiction, one should worry about guardianship. The concept of guardianship should be legally recognized. What does that mean? It means that when it comes to, say, the Amazon River Basin, rather than structure governance around seven or eight countries who need to sit at the table, they all have sovereign jurisdiction over bits of the Amazon, given that the Amazon is one single biome, and given that some of these countries are unable or unwilling to produce the protections that need to be in place for the forest to remain standing, then there might be a concept of guardianship. Are countries capable of exercising guardianship, or are they not? Even if they're sovereign, even if they exert formal sovereign jurisdiction, can they act as guardians? And if not, are there any other instances beyond the nation state that should be brought on board to ensure that critical biomes remain protected? So all of these compounds a situation in which foreign climate shaming is alive and kicking. The sources of climate shaming are really quite diverse. You have nation states that critique third parties over their climate policies. You have Hollywood stars and musicians who very publicly denounce countries for their lack of commitment to environmental preservation. You have NGOs. So if you're a country that is labeled as a climate outlaw, this is not just a problem for the governing elites, because the minute Lady Gaga and Leonardo DiCaprio begin, or President Biden, begin to publicly denounce the country, this becomes a problem for domestic public opinion. It's different from what happens when the Paris Agreement has a group of scientists that publicly says that country X has not complied with its commitment under the agreement. This is very public naming and shaming. This is the kind of stuff that goes straight to the TV sets and the mobile phones of voters across the board. So countries worry a lot about the rise of naming and shaming as an instrument of climate policy. So the question, the big important political question is, what are the effects? How do domestic publics react to foreign climate shaming? And the literature tells us that they react in four different ways. Publics could react by showing remorse and commitment to do better in the future. So when foreign climate shaming comes, people learn from the criticism. Research conducted in the United States shows that a very large chunk of the American population in the face of foreign climate shaming learn and express remorse. And they wonder whether they should keep voting for the same politicians they voted all along if these guys are incapable or unwilling to commit to climate action. A second potential reaction is silence. Many people in many parts of the world, when foreign climate criticism comes, they just keep quiet and wait for the storm to pass. And in surveys, you can identify who in the population are the people who show remorse and who are the people who prefer to stay quiet and wait for it to pass. There's a third group of people, and those are the people that will reject the criticism by questioning the motivations of the critics. These are the people who will say, well, the reason they're criticizing us, it's got nothing to do with the standing forest. It's probably to do with their trade interests. They want to criticize us because they want to conceal their own protectionism. That kind of reaction is the third possible reaction. And then there's the fourth reaction, and this is the problematic one. This is really dangerous. These are the people who are willing to defy foreign criticism. When foreign criticism arrives, these people want to double down on non-compliant behavior. They're willing to support politicians who, for example, burn down forests, all the more just to make the point that foreigners have no business in denouncing their domestic policies. So in making sense of how public opinion reacts to foreign climate shaming, we need to be able to distinguish these four reactions. We need to identify who the people who are willing to defy are, because defiance is the dangerous thing. And then we want to understand what are the predictors of defiance. What makes people more willing to defy? So to find that out, we run a survey experiment. This is not Latin America, it's just Brazil. We interviewed over 1,000 people. It's a nationally representative sample of Brazil. And we wanted to check several things. We wanted to check, does it make a difference if the obligation of the government of Brazil is legal or just moral? Maybe people are more sensitive when you tell them that Brazil has a legal commitment under Paris to curb carbon emissions and stop burning down the forest. We wanted to check, does it make a difference if the critic is perceived to be hypocritical or not? So if Joe Biden says Brazil should stop burning the forest, but President Bolsonaro tells the people, why would you pay attention to Joe Biden? He's telling us to stop burning the forest, but America keeps buying produce from burned forest. Hypocrisy. Does that make a difference? We wanted to know if the frame of the criticism makes a difference. Does it make a difference when Biden says, if Brazil burns down the forest, this will undermine the future of Brazilian children, versus Emmanuel Macron, who tweets, Brazil is burning our Amazon. The Amazon belongs to humanity, not to Brazil. So does it make a difference if the criticism is cosmopolitan, Macron, or if it's nation-based, Biden? Does it matter what the critic threatens? Biden can threaten with imposition of trade sanctions, for example, but an alternative would be to threaten the use of military force or diplomatic sanctions. Does that make a difference? And finally, does it matter if the source of criticism has a reputation for resolve? You know, Biden says, if Brazil doesn't stop burning down the forest, we're going to impose sanctions. Does it matter if America has a reputation for acting on its promises or not acting? If it's not credible, the threat, does that make a difference? So these are the things we tested with our survey. And what we found is the triggers of defiance. This is what I want to show you. There are two big important triggers of defiance in the climate sphere in a global South country, Brazil, a Latin American country. And there is one trigger of defiance that is important. It's not super powerful statistically, but it's important. So let me go one by one. The first one is the perception of hypocrisy. When publics perceive the critic to be hypocritical, this triggers the will to defy. This makes a lot of people in the sample say, you know what? I'm going to support anti-climate policies to make sure that this hypocritical critic, that we shut him up, basically. Bolsonaro knows this instinctively. He used to tell a lie, but a very clever lie. Whenever Macron would chide Brazil for burning down our Amazon, Bolsonaro would tell the people, let me tell you a story. Did you know that Europeans have burned down all of their forests? There are no forests in Europe anymore, because they burned it all down. They're being hypocritical. They're willing to burn theirs, but they won't let us burn ours. This is ludicrous, fake news, and yet we know that instinctively Bolsonaro knows that denouncing your critic as hypocritical will increase the number of people who are willing to defy the criticism rather than learn from it and show remorse and say, well, maybe I should change my vote. That's one thing. The other thing, and this is really interesting, the biggest predictor of defiance is the threat of military force. So the more intense the threat and punishment, the bigger the will to defy. I don't know why. Maybe it's because the threat of the use of military force is not credible, so people say, right, I'm going to double down on this thing, and I want to see if you're really willing to punish me through the use of military force. Might be that. I don't know. We haven't tested that. We didn't expect these results. Had we imagined these, we would have tested why on earth. But interestingly, the more acute the threat of punishment, the more willing the people are to defy the criticism. And then the other thing that really matters, you can't see, because of the way the PowerPoint works, this line is touching the vertical line. It shouldn't. This has a statistical effect that it's small, but it's nonetheless significant statistically, and that's the frame of the criticism. The use of cosmopolitan language, Macron saying our Amazon, that triggers defiance. I wish there were French diplomats in the audience because we could tell them that Macron needs to come up with better language so as not to induce a result that is at counter purposes with the intentions of the criticism, okay? All right, so these are the three big predictors of defiance, but we found something else, that these predictors are stronger, and not just stronger, they're much more strong on the political right. Individuals who self-identify with the political right are far more willing to defy on the three instances that we talked about, the perception of hypocrisy, the cosmopolitan frame of the criticism, and the threat of the use of military force. It's the political right that is pulling society to defy, far more than the left. I don't know why. We didn't test why, but this is what we found. So what are the implications of this story? And with this, I will end. And I'm have I really spoken for an hour? I'm sorry. They told me 35 minutes. So sorry. Oh my, okay guys, so very quickly. What are the implications and the future directions? First of all, for the international community, if you're going to criticize countries over their climate policies, you need to make sure that your criticism cannot be framed as hypocritical. Because the minute your target audiences perceive the criticism as hypocritical, you end up producing the opposite of what you wanted. You induce backlash, so don't. The other thing is, whenever the criticism is presented, whenever critical cues are put forward, it's much better to emphasize that the cost of compliance will affect nationals of the country you're criticizing and not the international community writ large. Because the minute people perceive your criticism as cosmopolitan, you induce the opposite effect of what you wanted. And finally, one of the things we need to find out, and no one's tested this ever, I don't think, not that I know of, is there anything at all that foreign countries and international institutions can say by way of criticism that informs people and prompts them to demand that their politicians comply with international norms, international climate norms. I'm sure there are messages on the back of these studies, now that we know what triggers what and what predicts what, it's plausible that we can come up with messages that are a bit cleverer, that are better designed and tailored to speak to audiences in target states in ways that don't alienate them, but that engage them and that get them on their feet and get them to embrace some kind of pro-climate action.
No, that's fine. Thank you so much, Matias. It's also my fault. I'm the moderator, but I was really interested in what you were saying and find it incredible that politicians in the region, particularly Bolsonaro, intuitively know what to say, unless he has read your studies, which I doubt. But I have two questions, and then I'll open it up for question. One is, if you ever considered that this strong awareness that there is climate change in Latin America that came out of your surveys, COVID had an impact on that. Because if you did this in December 2021, and there was a lot of talk in media that COVID might have been a consequence of climate change, deforestation, crowding of species, et cetera. That's one part of the question. And then the second part is, you said that individualism is the highest predictor about beliefs and causes and impact, but that there is no predictor in terms of political ideology. Is there a correlation between individualism and political ideology? Those were my two questions.
Really clever. This was the main reviewer question we got from Nature magazine. So good. And we hadn't thought about it. So yes, it's possible that COVID had a role in shaping the results we found. It's also possible that because of the list of countries that we tested, many of them are around the Amazon basin. At the time in 2019 and 2020, there were wildfires that were notorious for their degree of destruction. So these things may have affected results. And yet, to some extent, I doubt it, because we find this systematically over these countries. And we're looking at Mexico and Argentina at opposite ends of the hemisphere. And the results are so powerful that it seems to me that there tends to be a social consensus that this thing exists and that it's caused by humans. The big question for me, the thing I don't understand, is why does that not translate into political action? Green parties in Latin America are not powerful in any of the countries of the region. Politicians never really campaign around the issue of pro-climate action. The terms of the debate in the public sphere are nowhere near what you find in other societies that need to transition from oil and gas. So that's the one thing I don't really understand. Your second question is great. So we find that levels of individualism are a big driver, but not political ideology. So how did we define political ideology? We measured it two ways. We asked people to place themselves on a scale from left to right, and then we asked them to place themselves on a scale from conservative to progressive. And we found no effect on both scales on beliefs. But what is the scale of individualism? This is a metric that we didn't come up with. It's a standard survey question. And it measures people's preferences for the role of the state in society. Now, the role of state in society is an ideology. So liberalism is an ideology. So levels of individualism, the metric calls it that, but could the measure be a measure of ideology? Possibly, yes. So a study that needs to be done is, who are the Latin American liberals, liberal defined as people who would rather see the state have a limited role in society, because these are the people who are driving disbelief in the human causes and the severity of the consequences of climate change.
Thank you. I don't know if there's any questions. Maybe we can take two or three at a time.
Or three.
Or, yeah.
has one. Perfect.
Thank you. Matias, that was terrific. I want to quote Groucho Marx, and who said that, sorry, Kate, said, you know, who said that, you know, why should we worry about future generations? What have future generations ever done for us? And I'm just wondering whether you, I mean, I think that's a very prevalent attitude. In other words, people may believe that climate exists, that it's severe, even that it's imminent, but they're not prepared to take any action. They don't care, you know, and to make the argument, well, this is going to affect future generations. You know, I live today and I'm not going to sort of sacrifice what I have. And so I'm just wondering to what extent you may have picked that up, or if that's, you know, that's relevant. And the second question is, if you have any thoughts, since you're a very acute observer of everything, why the United States is such an outlier on this thing? I mean, how would you, if you had to point to some factor that explains that? I mean, it seems to be, compared to Latin America, compared to Europe, I mean, there's no political party in Latin America, or no political party in Europe that denies the existence of climate change. In this country, there is. So what explains that?
Let's take one more question, and then we can end with those.
Congratulations about your lecture. And I'm from Brazil, and I'd like to know what's the important role of environment education around the Latin American to change the results about the causes and impacts from and climate change. And then another question, what do you think about the agribusiness here in Brazil, specifically in Brazil, because in this group was supported by many politicians. Okay, thank you.
First question on the issue of future generations, the Groucho Marx story. The Economist magazine this week has a great piece on climate skepticism, and a lot of what it says is, well, in the rich world, one of the problems is that citizens, in particular older citizens, are so reluctant to take any action because it's not their problem. What have future generations done for us, right? The problem is that our finding is really strange, because we should have found that age should have some statistical effect. It has none for risk perception. So if you're older or younger, makes no difference as to how imminent you think the threat is going to be. But then we find no effect for age in any of the beliefs. So it's not a generational story in Latin America, but it is in the rich world. Here it is, and in Europe it is as well. So it's not about age. Really interesting, but I don't know why. Right? Your second question was about the US and partisanship. And your question is, what's so exceptional about the United States? The one big exceptional thing about the United States is that the issue of climate change has become polarized around partisanship. That's the phenomenon that we need to understand, right? Why on earth partisanship intersects with your belief in climate change? And this is a feature of extreme ideological polarization, right? Is what happens when you walk down the street and you look at someone, and by the way they dress, you can tell how they vote, right? So in this country, climate change has become enmeshed with that kind of world. The reasons why, you know, there's a library written on polarization and belief, the social psychology of polarization. What we can tell for sure is that in the case of Latin America, the reason we don't find anything like this is that political parties pay no attention to climate change. The minute they begin to do so, I think we're going to start seeing some polarization. Of course, Latin America is relatively protected because there are not many countries in the region that have polarized systems. In America, by design, you have two parties, right? In the bulk of Latin America, you have minority presidential systems in which, in order to govern, presidents need to put together coalitions that are ideologically heterogeneous. So there's no point in trying to promote partisan identity because that doesn't really take you anywhere, right? Europe is closer to the United States than is Latin America. Latin America seems to be, on the back of what we find, really immune to partisanship and to the conservative progressive divide, which to me is really strange. This is an opportunity for Latin America. You could have a conservative Latin America pro-climate platform, which is inconceivable in the United States. You could have a right-wing set of parties in Latin America saying, you know what? Climate action is essential to freedom, to economic freedom, if you want to ensure that the state is not going to come over and take over and control the economy. You need pro-climate action. That message, it's not implausible in Latin America, and I think that's a good thing, you know, compared to what we find here. To your question on education, great question. Again, bizarre thing, you know, level of education, where it's not here, but level of education has no effect other than in the belief in the existence of climate change, and I don't understand why. I don't know what the answer to that is. I don't know if it's to do with the quality of education. I don't know if it's to do with the fact that maybe climate change is not part of the curriculum. Or maybe there's something more profound. Our results suggest there's something going on in Latin America, which is very strange, and it's the fact that people's reactions to climate change are not mediated by cognition. That it's mediated by psychology rather than cognition. We don't know why, but we need to find out. And your last question on the role of agribusiness. You know, Latin America, one of the distinctive features of Latin American political systems is that they're particularly prone to state capture, right? Interest groups are unequally capable of capturing chunks of the state through various mechanisms. And one of the things that we know is that the agricultural sector historically has been enormously powerful in shaping national policy, and it's no different now. For the largest period of history, most agricultural interests in Latin America had no commitment at all with environmental protection, but now that's changing in some countries. So in Colombia, for example, there are interest groups now who realize that the costs of not complying with international climate law are going to be enormous. In Brazil, parts of the agribusiness community is very much committed to not letting the Europeans impose trade sanctions on Brazilian exports because that's going to come at an enormous cost. But in a nutshell, what I would say is there's one thing that would help Latin America get its act together and align domestic interest groups in a pro-climate action platform, and that would be if consumer markets for Latin American exports were to unite. That's not going to happen, though, because we are in the age of great power competition. But if China, the United States, and the European Union were to sit together and decide that from now on, Latin American exports that are high carbon footprint will not enter their markets, that's the one thing that would realign domestic interests. And then you would see Latin America, I think, beginning to comply big time. Of course, my view is very unpopular because, as we've learned, the minute you tell the people that you need to comply because some external actor is imposing the change on you, people react and there's backlash. But you get the gist.
Thank you, Matias, for spending time with us this afternoon and presenting your fascinating work. I learned a lot, and I hope you all enjoyed it and learned as well. Thank you so much.